know you're all hungry. I know a couple of you tried to grab my arms on the way up here, so I figured I'd do it. But thank you. Thank you for being here this morning. You'll see in the corner there's all of the team that puts it all together for your city every day. They're very anxious to serve you again. But I have to acknowledge a few people to begin with. First of all, we have Vice Mayor Anthony Tagliati. We have Kathleen Capusta. We'll just wait. Hold on, because we'll be here for 3 hours instead of the two we have planned. Just kidding. Kathleen, Bob Wagner. I saw Bob here. Then we have Superintendent Steve Marlowe. We have Bill McGinnis. We have Roger Howard. We have Ben Hagedish. We have Mel Termini from the schools. Russell Fortledge. I saw Russell here. Let's see who else now. And I saw Jim Trank is here. Jim, I know Jim's here. Jim, we have members of our business community that joined us this morning. And I need to acknowledge my mother, Dolores, and my wife, because I've seen enough events where you forget to acknowledge your better half, and boy, did you get hurt in the long run. So, and I see Dave Grindell and Carrier here. Okay. So, and if I miss anybody, I'll catch you on the next round. Before I go any further, I want to invite Donna Barrett up here. Donna, I need to congratulate you for being the first woman ever to be elected to the office of General Presbyter for Ohio for the Assemblies of God Church. How about a round of applause for you? Donna will be representing Ohio in the National Presbyter. Again, Donna, thank you very much for being here. She's such a great friend and so good in this community. Donna Barrett.
Good morning. Let's bow our heads and pray together, shall we? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we pause to acknowledge your lordship over our lives and our great love for you. God, we pray that you would bless this food to nourish our bodies. We pray, Lord, that you will open heaven over the city of Independence. Lord, we pray for your help and your guidance for each and every public servant in this city. We pray, Lord, that you will be honored and glorified by everything that is done. Lord, bless this meeting today. Bless our mayor. In Jesus' name, we pray these things. Amen. Thank you.
Okay, let's see. Now, next, before we start to serve, I want a moment of silence for those that were here last year that aren't here this year. Moment of silence. Okay, where are my gloves? Okay, we're going to serve you now. Showcase this morning. So we have a great event planned for you, the State of the City. But before I get into the State of the City, I have to acknowledge, how many saw the quilt when you walked in? Ah. Pat Ellert's here. Pat, I know you're here. Judy Biggie and Elaine Wise, let's put that together. And when you walk out, and you're walking out of the community center, portion, look above you and you'll see it's hanging there. It's going to be hanging there for a while. It's absolutely beautiful. And I can't say enough about that group of ladies that worked so hard to put that together. So, here we go. This is my 21st year as serving as your mayor. It's been an honor and a privilege. Thank you. The cornerstone for our community has been stability and consistency. I would say the city has grown tremendously since 1986. As a matter of fact, our tax duplicate has grown from roughly $170 million to $500 million. And income tax since 1986 has grown by about fivefold. So I think we've experienced a tremendous amount of growth. And I see some of our business leaders here, and I want to thank them for their commitment and their investment in our community. That means so much for having our business community behind us. One other important point I want to make is this facility, the Civic Center. You know, by way of history, when we tried to get this passed in the late 80s, it failed three times. And finally, by a mere 32 votes, it passed. We wouldn't have this facility. I remember talking to the seniors at the old rec building and how important it was to have a new facility. And you know, it's really a fantastic experience when you walk in this facility. This facility itself, since the early 90s, has done so much for so many. More people come through this facility on a daily basis than any other facility in the city. It's actually the heart and soul of this entire community. Your mind is taken care of with the library. You challenge your body with recreation facilities, and the heart and soul of our community is this branch of it, right, the Community Services Department. On a daily basis, you'll see the emotional support and the relational support. I see some of the people in the audience that are here on a daily basis having their coffee clutches, and they're solving all the city's problems. And the reason I know that is because they tell me. So, again, the Civic Center and this comprehensive use of and benefit to the community is so important. But, you know, the community, the growth and advancement that we've experienced in the last, you know, 20, 30 years didn't happen by accident. It took a vision of a greater and better future, planning to chart the course for that better future. And it took fortitude to plow through some of the challenges and some of the naysayers and the skeptics. We don't have those in Independence, but that was supposed to be funny. But today I think it's important that we showcase the importance of the people that work so hard to provide these services on a daily basis to you. No organization succeeds without a group of individuals coming together to work towards common goals. And that's teamwork. And you know, over the years, we've had so many individuals that have done such a great job providing their gifts to the city, their talents and their time and their resources. I've worked with dozens of city council members over the years, probably 9 city councils and for sure dozens of city councilmen. Boards and commissions, you know, those that are privileged to serve on these boards and commissions don't get paid or get paid a small stipend. They're very generous with their time and their talent, and you see the results of it on Rockside Road, Pleasant Valley, and through the community. The department directors, which served you this morning, and we're going to showcase them, you will see the tremendous amount of responsibility they have in managing the resources which council and you, the taxpayer, provide for them. The volunteers, well, that goes without saying. I see, as I scan the crowd, a number of you still give back to your community. And of course, all the employees, the team members that work for you on a daily basis. And I think most importantly, the business community, which is so important to the growth and sustainability of our community. And then you, the residents, because without you and what you've, the contributions you've made to this community, we wouldn't be a great city that we are. And the quality of life, well, I don't know if you can find a community that presents a better quality of life than we have in our city. Now, this morning, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to feature the directors and their teams, the people on the front lines, the day-to-day delivery of services to everyone in this city, everyone that drives through the city, and everyone that works in the city, and of course, everyone that lives in here. Because we want to be the premier Northeast Ohio community in which to live, work, visit my friends from New York, and to raise a family. And that's what we do on a daily basis. So we are able to because we are blessed. We're blessed with the right location and the right resources and the right teamwork. And I can also say that it's in part due to the strong, proactive financial management team that we've assembled that makes sure that we utilize those dollars in a positive manner. And these teams that we've assembled with the guidance of the directors, they do a phenomenal job, as I said. So we're going to showcase them this morning. And one more thing, on your tables, you have clickers. We're having a little interactive play today, so I need you to pay attention when we have these videos because you'll be asked to, I want to see how smart you are. Well, I already know. But we have a few questions to answer. So let's begin with the first one, residential enhancement, community services and recreation department. Community services and recreation departments are the heart and soul of our community. They touch more lives on a daily basis than anyone else. So, residential enrichment.
The mission statement of the Community Services Department is enriching the lives of residents. We have a service-oriented team that is dedicated to meeting the needs of our residents 7 days a week. As family dynamics change, our department is always seeking creative ways to offer services and programming for all ages, from 6 months old to seniors in their 90s. Our programmers are passionate about creating entertaining and memorable experiences. We offer a variety of youth programs at both the community center and field house, many of which are designed to accommodate working parents. We've experienced record numbers this past year with a total attendance of 136 children in summer playground and 172 children in summer camp. It's no surprise that our programs will fill up quickly because of our staff does an amazing job at a great value. We are always seeking new ways to increase the efficiency of our department and to improve the customer experience for our residents and their guests. With convenience in mind, we try to incorporate technology in order to make things as simple as possible. We started with online registration, which has seen a huge increase over this past year. With the mayor's support, we are pleased to offer No Place Like Home services, which allow our residents to remain in their homes as long as possible. We offer a daily welfare check, Lifeline medical alert, and Meals on Wheels delivery to those that are homebound. We provide transportation services to eligible residents throughout the week for medical appointments, non-leisure errands, and to the community center. Our department has recently been restructured to improve our success as a team and as individuals, including a licensed social worker that is available to help residents of all ages. Our transport and bus drivers have received National Safety Council training, as well as first aid and are certified in CPR. At the community center, we encourage wellness, not only for physical health, but personal well-being. Our goal is to improve the lives of our residents by offering programs and services that are not only beneficial, but also enjoyable. We offer daytime, evening, and weekend bus trips that appeal to all interests, ranging from Broadway shows to sports. We take the hassle of driving and parking out of the equation, and our bus offers wheelchair accommodations. Our dedicated team plans special events throughout the year that bring thousands to enjoy the festivities, such as Fall Fest and Holiday Fest. We also honor our veterans and military annually on Memorial Day and Veterans Day. We are fortunate to have a beautiful facility not only to house our programs, but residents can also rent the banquet rooms for their own parties. Memories are made here as many have celebrated special occasions such as birthdays, showers, and even weddings. We strive to meet the ever-changing needs of our residents. We hope to earn lifelong trust and friendships by providing a warm, welcoming, family-like environment. We will continue to move forward with technology and offer our residents the best. I encourage you to stop in and visit, have a cup of coffee, and meet our caring and friendly staff.
Hi, my name is Tom Olchanowicz. Here at the Recreation Department, we live our mission statement every day. We're committed to excellence in programming, facilities, and service by all and for all. The main hub of our activity centers around our 6,200 square foot Civic Center, which was built in 1991. More than 3,700 pass holders enjoy our indoor and outdoor amenities, and this number continues to grow as residents take advantage of programming and services for all ages. This year, the Recreation Department embarked on a series of much-needed capital and facility improvements. At the outdoor pool, some of the improvements include new swim team racing lanes and an automatic swimsuit dryer. Also new at the outdoor pool this year is the ability to renew your memberships and sign up for programming right at the pool entrance window. To make the process even easier, you can now even renew your outdoor pool memberships from the convenience of your home computer. Over at the Civic Center, the weight room areas underwent some extensive improvements. Glass partitions and two knee walls were removed to add more floor space and give the room a more open feeling. The original carpet was removed and replaced with sports flooring. Other added items include a 51-inch television monitor and two banks of wall-mounted lockers with resettable personal combinations, which will help keep your small valuables secure while using the facility. 10 new workout machines were also added this year. Most were purchased following a demo period that allowed residents to test the machines and offer feedback, ensuring these new pieces complemented our current equipment. Other improvements include the purchase of a material spreader for salt distribution and applying ball field materials evenly and consistently. What used to be accomplished by manpower, shovels, and rakes is now done better, faster, and more cost-effectively. Improvements were also made to the Elmwood Recreation Building gym. Heater grates were reconfigured for safety, and the entire gym received a color-coordinated paint job which matched our other facilities. In the park, you may have noticed our aluminum park benches have been getting a makeover with earth tone colors. Our youth recreation program continues to be a hallmark of our community. Included in this year's expanded programming was an Indian summer baseball camp and a new 3- and 4-year-old t-ball league. Our flag football program now encompasses grades kindergarten through 6. The Haunted House for Fall Fest has been extended and will be open 3 additional days in October with an added costume contest and other activities each night. The Fieldhouse Complex is another one of our highly utilized facilities with its 200-meter track and 4 multi-purpose courts. The Fieldhouse is a hub of activity that serves over 30,000 visitors each year. From the Kyrie Irving basketball camp to the fencing and taekwondo events, this major center for a community activity brings residents together through their shared interest in athletics, sportsmanship, and fitness. Started in the fall of 2013, a sponsorship program for businesses to advertise at the Fieldhouse provided the perfect partnership, offering commercial exposure while generating an additional revenue stream for the city. The Recreation Department is reaching out to the community through our website, Twitter, and Facebook to connect and communicate up-to-date information. In an effort to go green, the department is also utilizing more online forms, providing paperless reservations and rentals. This year's improvements are only the beginning. Next year, the Recreation Department will take another leap into the digital age with our own mobile app, which will allow residents to get up-to-date information at the touch of a button. Capital improvements to the tennis courts will introduce a new sport to the mix, as a popular game called pickleball will be added to one of the courts. Major building projects also include the addition of a new mini pavilion, which will be located by the baseball diamond complex for teams and families to enjoy. Here at Recreation, the possibilities are endless. We're always striving to have the latest state-of-the-art equipment and are determined to provide the utmost excellence in programs and facilities for all our residents. The Recreation Department team members look forward to continued our premier level of service to you, our residents. Thank you.
Now, doesn't that make you proud to be a resident of Independence? Now, get your clickers ready. We're gonna have a little fun. How many square feet in the Civic Center? 45, 62, 80, or 100? Are you ready? Where's your clicker? Look, I don't want any fighting going at the tables now. There's only one clicker, so whoever holds it, they have the power. Okay, ready? Let's see. Well, the majority of you got it right. Let's see, it's 62,000. Oh, yes, even I know that. Perfect. The rest of you can stay after and I'll give you a little lesson. Another area we want to talk about today is police, fire, and mayor's courts. Public safety. We define this as public safety. These departments serve you on a moment's notice, protecting and serving you on a daily basis. An integral part of the police department is the mayor's court. Mayor's court office team works with defendants to get them the help they need to turn their lives around and get them back on the right track, making good choices. You know, a lot of you know, your children, your parents, yourselves, there's challenges in this world. And our safety forces, and through the efforts of the mayor's court team, they do a great job of trying to guide people in the right path to get them back on a road to prosperity when they slip. We're all human. They do a great job. So let's take a second look at the second segment, public safety.
I am Fire Chief Steve Riga, and I'm proud to lead the personnel of the Independence Fire Department. It is our mission to enhance life in the community by providing protection to life and property through compassion and teamwork. The almost 10 square miles that we serve is very diverse, with many of the challenges seen by much larger communities. In addition to our residential population, our business and commercial districts consist of hundreds of buildings and many high-rise structures. Close to 200,000 vehicles travel our interstates and roadways each day. As a result, our personnel responded to 132 motor vehicle accidents last year. Another key feature of Independence is our national park system. Our department works hard to meet these challenges. Its 21 full-time and 9 part-time personnel respond to over 1,650 incidents last year. That included 1,129 EMS calls and 529 fire-related emergencies. Our fire prevention and shift personnel conducted close to 700 inspections last year, utilizing our completely paperless iPad documentation system. The information is entered in the field, wirelessly transferred, and later recalled for use in emergency scenes. The department operates 3 advanced life support ambulances, and each is equipped with the latest in emergency medical equipment. For our medical training needs, we have partnered with the Cleveland Clinic's Marymount Hospital. They provide us with monthly on-site learning and the latest in medical direction. Our fire equipment is highlighted by our new fire engine, which was designed to meet the needs and challenges of our community. It carries the latest in vehicle extrication equipment and was designed for emergency work on our freeways. Its high visibility markings, LED lighting system, and operational functionality were all incorporated to increase firefighter safety on the roadways. Partnering closely with other regional departments, we share in the cost of other needed equipment, such as our recently acquired all-terrain vehicles and fit test equipment. We also are members of the Southwest Emergency Response Team that has numerous assets available to us when needed. We also offer many programs to our community. Last year, we conducted over 720 public relations activities related to these programs. They include the Lifeline Program, Home Safety Evaluation, Child Seat Safety seat checks, blood pressure and glucose checks, department tours and talks, CPR, first aid, and fire extinguisher training. Our Phillips Lifeline program offers peace of mind to our senior residents, knowing that help is only the push of a button away. All Lifeline systems are installed and maintained by our fire department personnel. Currently, we have over 170 participants in our program, and on average, we respond to 60 Lifeline calls for help each year. Public education and community involvement is also a big part of what we do. Each year, we visit our schools, businesses, and community center for educational talks. We also participate in the many community events and fundraisers for charity. To sum up our mission, we at the Independence Fire Department are proud to serve the community, and there is much we have to offer. As we have said many times before, just call us if you need us.
Hello. I'm Mike Kilbane, and I'm honored to serve as the Chief of the Independence Police Department. The men and women of the Independence Police Department are committed to providing levels and quality of service that are unmatched by other police departments. Our team's goal is to maintain Independence's standard as the absolutely best place to raise a family, work, or visit. We work closely with our partners in other city departments, as well as outside agencies, to not only address and respond to current issues, but to anticipate potential future trends and plan accordingly. When calls initially come into the safety services, the first point of contact is our central dispatch center. Whether the issue calls for police, fire, EMS, or a combination of services, our experienced professional dispatch staff make sure that the callers get the help they need as quickly as possible. Our dispatch center features state-of-the-art technology using the Sundance Records Management System, and all of our dispatchers are trained and certified in emergency medical dispatching, allowing them to provide life-saving medical instructions to callers while help is on the way. They are also in constant contact with units in the field using radio communications, as well as exchanging information via the mobile data terminals in each police car. Patrol officers are the most visible unit of the police department, and these officers receive high levels of ongoing training so they can effectively respond to a wide variety of calls for service. We have also recently instituted a bike patrol, giving our officers the flexibility to respond and patrol in areas of the city that are harder to reach in a patrol car. The bike officers log a lot of time in our Rockside Road business areas, as well as the city park and campus, and you'll see them in your neighborhoods as well. We have two canine teams, Patrolman Jim Green and his partner Pato, and Patrolman Shane Bates and his partner Chino. Our canines are proficient in tracking, apprehension, and drug detection. We also have officers assigned to the Southwest Enforcement Bureau SWAT team and bomb squad, and these resources are available whenever the need arises. Traffic safety is one of the primary functions of our patrol division, and our department uses data analysis to focus our enforcement and educational efforts at times and location where safety issues have been identified. We also respond to traffic concerns that are voiced by citizens, and we are constantly assessing and responding to emerging traffic issues. With the ongoing improvement projects on our interstates, we instituted a focused enforcement program to ensure construction zone safety. This program was so successful that the Ohio Department of Transportation is adopting it as a standard for construction projects throughout the state. The police department has a very close relationship with the schools within the city, working together to provide a safe and supportive environment for our children. Sergeant Brad Barowe is assigned to work with the schools and provides numerous educational and support programs for students and staff. Sergeant Barowe recently facilitated ALICE crisis response training for the staffs of all three independent school system buildings and continues to work with the school administration to upgrade and enhance the school's safety plans. Our Detective Bureau conducts follow-up investigations and prepares and presents cases to the courts. The detectives use modern technology, such as advanced computer forensics and video analysis to investigate cases, and they have one of the highest rates of case clearance of any police department in the county. We also have a detective assigned to work with the High-Intensity Drug Area Traffic Task Force. This task force consists of local, state, and federal agencies combining resources to conduct high-level drug investigations. Policing a city such as Independence creates a large amount of data and paperwork, and our administrative staff and data entry is tasked with collecting and organizing that information. Various reports need to be distributed to several different courts, the media, the state, and other law enforcement agencies, and the administrative staff effectively and efficiently keeps the department moving. On behalf of the entire police department, I want to say we are proud to be part of the outstanding team here at the City of Independence. And if there is anything we can do for you, please don't hesitate to call us.
Hi, my name is Angie Zalesnik-Zadanek, and I am privileged to serve as the clerk of court for the City of Independence. Our highly skilled team includes our prosecutor, William Doyle, Cindy Metz, our chief deputy clerk, Catherine Turkovich, our deputy clerk, and of course, Mayor Gregory Kurtz, who presides over mayor's court with a firm but gentle hand. Our court is defined by its leading and progressive role in the community, acting as an agent for education, growth, and change. In our handling of criminal and traffic offenses, the court strikes a balance between consequences and support, and we are committed to promoting excellence in the lives of those that come through our door. Come on, let me show you how we do this. The primary role of the court office is to prepare cases for tickets written by the Independence Police. Some cases are transferred to Juvenile Court and Garfield Heights Municipal Court, but most stay here in Mayor's Court. We are required by law to report those cases to the Bureau of Motor Vehicles and the Supreme Court of Ohio. Just this year, we began receiving tickets electronically from the police department. This means no more duplication of effort between court and police, which saves the city time and money. And we use the same technology when we transfer cases to Garfield Heights Municipal Court. The rapid export process puts information into the judge's hands quickly so they can hear the case without delay. Mayor's Court is in session every Wednesday. For the protection of the public and city workers, the court utilizes a metal detector to ensure the safety of everyone in the building. We utilize technology wherever possible to deliver the highest level of customer service. The court staff also functions as the Violations Bureau, collecting payments that do not require a court appearance. For the convenience of the public, tickets can be paid online with no additional fee. For some, their experience with the court ends with payment of their fine. Others continue on, and we focus our efforts on rehabilitation through court programs. We utilize many programs to target issues facing each defendant, like anger management, drug testing and alcohol programs, even individual counseling that help get them back on track while minimizing the likelihood that they will reoffend. We are in partnership with Cuyahoga County Juvenile Court, and through our community diversion program, we work with youth offenders. We've even designed our own alternative sentencing programs to address their unique needs, which are now available in other cities as well. We do not believe in punishment without giving people the opportunity to educate themselves. There's no better way to stay out of trouble than to understand what got you there in the first place. We also made a commitment many years ago to invest in the future of our youth, which we have done through our strong relationships with the schools, the parents, students, churches, and businesses that make up 25 and Alive, our community partnership. Together, we are able to bring valuable school assemblies and programs to the community. Our Mayor's Court team is proud to be a part of delivering outstanding services in the city, and we are committed to ensuring that Independence is the best community in which to live, work, visit, and raise a family.
Okay. Now, notice that the fire truck the chief was standing in front of was brand new, it's state of the art. How much did it cost? The clicker. Ready? Let's see what you said. 1 minute. Click the button. There we go, let's see. 37%, $550,000. Well, okay. We're doing all right. We're still winning. You know, one point I want to make is when Angie was speaking about the mayor having a firm but gentle hand, I got the firmness from my father, but the gentleness from my mother. I just won today, by the way. Another area I want to talk about is public works. Public works. Now you say, what's public works? Well, public works is a combination of our billing department, service department, tech services, and engineering department. They're not as glitzy or glamorous as the rest of them, but public works is the umbrella for all of us. They're vitally important. They make sure that the houses and the buildings are safe. They make sure that the roads and the sewers, the water lines, and the sidewalks are constructed properly, well-maintained, and safe. They also pick up the rubbish. They plow the streets. And the most important thing I think they're responsible for is managing and maintaining the overall image of our city. So let's take a closer look at public works.
Hello, I am Michael Giroux, the building official for the City of Independence, and welcome to the building department. Our team consists of Pam, Debbie, Becky, and Lori, who will be able to assist you when you call or stop in. The building department functions to provide a safe built environment for the residents and public who visit the city. We work to accomplish this by registering contractors, reviewing plans, issuing permits, and inspecting for compliance with the city codes. We also assist residents in developing a compliant resolution for their projects and problems. We maintain a presence in both local and state building official organizations, which keeps us on the cutting edge of technology and education in the industry. The building team consistently works towards streamlining procedures within the department. This effort helps to make the permitting process simpler and more efficient. Currently on the buildings portion of the city website, you will find the forms needed to apply to the Board of Zoning Appeals for a variance or to present your next project to the Architectural Board of Review for approval. The forms to make application for the building permit for your shed or fence are also on the website. In fact, all permit application forms are available on the website. Just this past year, we implemented new software in the department. This will improve the system of record keeping for contractor registrations, permits, and inspections. This will also provide us in the future with the basis for the online registration of contractors and the ability to process permits online. We currently have gone paperless with our inspection reports by emailing all reports either to the contractor or property owner when requested. The new software plays an important part in establishing a systematic property maintenance inspection program over the next year. The engineering department utilizes the same software, which provides for the ability to cross-train between departments. The two departments currently collaborate, and we are working towards expanding that collaboration. One project in the works is a one-stop packet for owners or builders, which will include all the necessary information from both departments for a new dwelling. Over the last year, we have entered into a cooperative agreement with Brecksville to share inspectors on a as-needed basis, a type of mutual aid agreement. The inspectors from Brecksville are able to perform inspections in Independence, and I am able to perform inspections in Brecksville when the need arises. This enables us to have properly certified inspectors available at all times. We also have expanded our pool of plans examiners to provide us with the flexibility when we have multiple projects being submitted. The zoning and building ordinances of the city are continually reviewed to keep them current and functional for today's world. The past year, the garage sale and private auto sale ordinances were modified, transferring the processing from the police department to the building department. This provides easier tracking of the permits, especially with the new software. The sign ordinance is in the final stages of revamping, and the fence ordinance is next on the list for review. Please stop in or call if we can assist you in any way, or if just to say hello.
Good morning. My name is Don Ram. I'm the City Engineer for Independence. I'm glad to be speaking to you this morning during the State of the City breakfast. Over the last 4 years, under the Mayor's leadership, your engineering department has steadily grown into a small but dynamic group of competent professionals. Our six-person department is accountable for a wide variety of day-to-day duties and responsibilities that affect our many customers, who include residents, developers, builders, contractors, businesses, design professionals, and utility companies, to name a few. With such a wide customer base, a typical day in the engineering department could include Office Coordinator Janine Baim, Administrative Assistant Judy Porterfield-Martin, handling phone calls, paying invoices, issuing permits, assisting customers at the counter, or Assistant Engineer Joe Potoma, working with the service department at a residence house, televising to investigate sewers, or Assistant Engineer Clark Mertes, reviewing improvement plans for a development site, or Engineering Technician Milt Gazalanchik, researching plans for an upcoming utility project, or myself, planning and prioritizing infrastructure projects within our 5-year capital plan. A primary focus of the department involves oversight and stewardship of the city's public infrastructure systems, namely the roads, traffic signal systems, storm and sanitary sewers, stormwater management facilities, and water mains. Within the last couple years, the city made capital purchases of high-tech sewer televising equipment at a collective cost that approached $200,000. This equipment utilization has allowed members of the service and engineering departments to respond quicker to resident sewer issues and to diagnose sewer problems much more efficiently and effectively. This equipment has been working overtime in response to residential flooding experienced on May 12th. The mayor and the city council authorized infrastructure-related expenditures totaling nearly $9 million in just the first 6 months of 2014. The largest accomplishment thus far this year has been the advancement of the East Pleasant Valley Widening and Rehabilitation Project. This $6.3 million project, recently commenced, is scheduled to be complete by this time next year and will mitigate traffic congestion and will improve the level of service for our businesses and commuters along this major east-west route. We are currently at the tail end of an important interchange modification study. Pending approval by ODOT and the Federal Highway Administration, the city plans to make major upgrades to the I-77 southbound entrance ramp and to the northbound entrance loop ramp, which will significantly improve traffic flow along the entire Rockside Road corridor, particularly at the I-77 interchange. And by now you are well aware that our contractor is in the middle of reconstructing the north drive entrance to Elmwood Park. This project removes the last deteriorated asphalt segment of Pete Wisniewski Parkway and replaces it with new concrete pavement consistent with the rest of the park road. So as you can see, the engineering department gets excited about infrastructure, and over the last 4 years, under the mayor's leadership, the city has had much success with major intersection and traffic signal upgrades along the Brecksville Road corridor, specifically at Selig Drive, Hillside Road, and East Pleasant Valley Road. In addition, many roads have been resurfaced in our subdivisions, on our campus, and in our commercial and business districts. We are even more excited about the next 4 years, as we plan to reconstruct and improve Beverly Drive off of Eastview Drive, to improve Brecksville Road north of Maple Shade Cemetery to the Cloverleaf, to design and construct improvements in our northwest and northeast quadrants that should jumpstart economic development and in income tax generation, to construct the Hemlock All-Purpose Trail connecting the Brecksville Road and Selig Drive intersection to the canal towpath in Valley View, to aggressively rehabilitate and resurface deteriorated roads throughout the city, to mitigate flooding conditions in our problematic residential and commercial areas. So this time next year, expect to hear reports on these and other successful projects that will move the city forward in positive ways that you can be proud of. Thank you for your time and attention. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Good morning. My name is Leon Karras, and I am proudly serving as your Assistant Service Director for the City of Independence. I would like to take a few moments today to illustrate a few essential services we provide to you, the residents of Independence. I would also like to highlight some of the work we do on a daily basis to continue to make your city a beautiful place to live and work in. With nearly 3,000 households and 7,200 residents, one of the most important services we provide is waste and recycling collection. Throughout the year, we collect approximately 3,100 tons of waste, 940 tons of recyclables. The collection of these materials over the years has been able to be done more efficiently and safely utilizing new technologies such as the city's automated collection vehicles. On a daily basis, the department services an average of 600 homes with only two trucks, one for waste and one for recycling collection. Since the city began using the automated trucks, the hours spent collecting waste and recycling has been greatly reduced. In addition to waste and recycling, the department also collects nearly 3,900 tons of yard waste material. This material is collected weekly along with your waste and recycling. This year, we have asked residents to no longer contain yard waste material in plastic bags. And if a bag must be used, please use a brown paper yard waste bag. By doing so, we will be able to safely and more efficiently collect your yard waste. Once the yard waste is collected, it is transported to the city's compost facility located on Old Rockside Road, where it is stored and then processed into compost for delivery to the residents. I am happy to say that this past summer, the department delivered 272 loads of compost, totaling 1,360 yards. By implementing new policies and using new technologies available to us, the service department will continue to provide services to the residents that will not increase the department's need for additional tax dollars. In addition to the weekly waste services provided to the residents, the department also offers chipper service for branches that are too large for regular weekly yard waste collection. Furthermore, the department provides dumpster service. For a small fee, we can deliver to the resident a 5 or 10 yard dumpster to be used for general cleanup, do-it-yourself projects, and other landscape materials. Throughout the summer, the department has 4 two-man crews responsible for landscape maintenance for all public lands outside of the parks. This includes cutting over 50 acres of grass throughout the city, maintaining dozens of flower beds, hanging baskets, cul-de-sacs, and many other areas of responsibility. One of our most important services we provide during the winter months is plowing the snow of the nearly 100 lane miles of city roads. This year, the department will utilize 3 tandem axle trucks and 5 single axle trucks during heavy snowfalls. This past year, we purchased a new tandem axle hook lift truck, which will allow us to better serve large roads like Rockside Road, Brecksville Road, and Pleasant Valley Road. As we do with all of our equipment, we look to purchase the finest and most technologically advanced equipment to provide long-term cost savings. The new plow truck has an onboard computer, which is calibrated to allow for the ideal amount of salt applied to our roadways. By having this technology on the truck, as well as 2 other trucks, we will be able to utilize less salt, which in turn decreases the cost of salt to the city. Our continued commitment to you is to provide a high level of service to all the residents of the City of Independence. Examine equipment which is best suited for the city and its residents. Discover the lowest cost methods to providing the exceptional services you are accustomed to. Develop and refine internal policies in order to provide you the most responsive solution to your service issues. Thank you for allowing me the pleasure to serve as your Assistant Service Director. If you have any questions regarding some of the services I have mentioned today, please go to the city's website or simply call us at 216-524-9191. Thank you and have an outstanding day in beautiful Independence, Ohio.
You might ask or wonder, what is the Technical Service Department in the City of Independence? What do they do? As President Reagan would say, well, I'm going to tell you. Let's take a walk along our infrastructures. Tech Service handles all the repairs in over 400,000 square feet of our municipal buildings. From the moment you walk through the doors in any of our city facilities, our highly trained technicians are involved in maintenance, repair, and installation of building automation, HVAC, electrical, lighting, plumbing, alarm systems, and more. We complete 90% of our projects in-house. One of our most recent large projects was the complete restoration of Historic Hall entranceway. The phases of our work included the complete removal and replacement of ceiling plaster with major portions of the wall areas, along with a comprehensive electrical update. Next, we completed the installation of a new HVAC unit, new hardwood flooring, as well as lighting and carpet to put the finishing touches on the project. Another project that we completed in time for our bicentennial celebration was the installation of new high-efficiency pedestal lights at City Hall. These new lights could be seen lining the walkway as you approach the front entrance of the building. These lights were chosen to match the colonial-style architecture that is duplicated throughout a picturesque city. This is an example of the many new lighting projects that we have completed in the last few years, including the service garage, Elmwood Recreation Building, maintenance garage, and portions of the Civic Center. We install the latest high-efficiency lights with emphasis on energy consumption along with maximizing bulb life. We are able to track these savings through our building automation systems. These systems are designed to maximize efficiency through programming that turns units on or off and controls temperatures, all while keeping our residents comfortable. One exciting opportunity that we are pursuing is the replacement of the light fixtures along our city streets and in our parking lots. The new fixtures we are testing use 60% less electricity and have a bulb life 3 times our current fixtures. New LED technology allows these lights to operate at 100% of their capacity at dusk, or they can be programmed to operate at 50% in the early hours of the morning and increase back up to 100%. This new lighting technology not only replaces the old dull yellow high-pressure sodium lights with a nice white light, it is the ultimate in energy savings. New technology like LED lighting is not the only thing we are excited about. During the gas mainline replacement along Brecksville Road, Mayor Kurtz had the foresight to instruct us to install a 4-inch conduit with pole boxes every 300 feet. This line travels from Selig Drive heading north, connecting to existing lines on Rockside Road. This was an important revision that will accommodate our current needs. We are working with IT and police to provide traffic cameras that assist in controlling the flow of traffic on both Brecksville and Rockside Road, allowing our police department to control traffic at congestion at peak times. These cameras have the added benefit of adjusting traffic lights in times of emergency, with emphasis on safety for everyone traveling our roads. In this day and age, you can't be too safe. Tech Service plays a big part in campus security, from upgrading key card access at high priority doors to future installation of cameras at key locations. Keeping our residents safe and secure on our campus grounds is a high priority. We are also working with the IT department to provide Wi-Fi campus-wide. Along with daily maintenance work orders, these are just some of the services that the Technical Service Department of Independence provides to our residents.
Okay, how many lane miles do we have that they plow every time it snows? How many lane miles? Push the button. Okay. Okay, Jim. Okay, that's 75% realized. But you know, the other ones aren't wrong because they keep going over them and over them and over them. So you can say 210, 295, 400, you're all right. You're all right. And the final segment we want to talk about today is very simple. It's called Show Me the Money. Finances. Finance department, purchasing department, economic development, and the mayor's office. Finances are more than just working with numbers, figures, spreadsheets, or computers. Finances affect the quality of life for all of our residences and our business community. Through proactive, foresighted leadership, together with all the people, the stakeholders, the council, mayor's office, finance department, we are attempting always to try for a safe, stable, and strong financial position in our city. As a matter of fact, Moody's, the rating service, recently rated the city AA1 credit rating, which is the second highest for a government entity. What's the significance of that, you ask? Well, let me share this with you. We just did a borrowing of $4.7 million. And through that rating, we were able to, yesterday, Wednesday, I found out from the finance director, save $480,000 by our excellent credit rating. And that's significant when you're borrowing the kind of money we have to borrow. So we have the second highest credit rating. We can borrow substantial monies in a very cheap form. And a big round of applause, I think, is important for John Veras, Vern Blaze, and the finance team. We talk about finances, we have to talk about economic development. The work of Jeremy Rowan, our economic development director, and his assistant, Liberty Shendell, at Liberty's here, is crucial to solidifying a safe, stable, and strong financial future for the City of Independence. Now we'll pay attention to the last segment.
Good morning, my name is John Amberis. I have been your finance director since January 1st, 2000, and prior to that, served as a member of council from January 1st, 1996 through December 31st, 1997. I've been a certified public accountant since 1993. Here in finance, our motto is a department for others. What that means is that without other departments, we don't exist. So we strive to be available to help each and every department with their purchasing, payroll, and budgeting needs. The better trained and assisted each department is, the more efficient the city runs as a whole. One example of this was the institution of totally paperless payroll system that pays everyone electronically directly into their specific account, thus eliminating lost, stolen, or uncashed checks. The annual budget is due to the county by March 31st of the year being budgeted. However, we have strived to have the budget prepared and approved by the first of the year, thereby knowing the annual budget before the year starts. As part of the budgeting process, we have also implemented a 5-year capital improvement plan, which has taught council and department heads to look past the current annual budget and plan for the next 5 years for the city's departmental capital and infrastructure needs. Managing our debt is also a very important part of what we do in finance. Back in the early 2000s, when the city finally had the opportunity to partner with federal, state, and county funding sources to widen Rockside Road, we took on a heavy debt load. I told council at the time that I would not recommend going forward with the widening project without the financing concept I introduced, namely tax increment financing or TIF financing. To date, TIF financing has brought over $8.7 million in additional revenue, most of which can be used for Rockside Road. In closing, I want to assure you that our entire staff continues to look for ways to improve efficiencies and for ways to make your tax dollars work harder. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Gus Katsis, and I'm the city's new purchasing coordinator. I came on board in February of this year after spending 24 years at Cleveland Metro Parks as a senior buyer. I'd like to talk a little bit about value-oriented purchasing. Here in purchasing, our main goal is to obtain all of the city's goods and services at the best possible value and highest quality, while at the same time making sure that our taxpayers' monies are spent in full compliance with all local and state laws. As a resident of the city, it's important to me, as I know it is to all of you. One of the best tools we have at our disposal to accomplish value purchasing is the use of cooperative purchasing agreements. The City of Independence is a member of the State of Ohio's Cooperative Purchasing Program, as well as the Ohio Department of Transportation. We even participate in a local cooperative comprised of 10 neighboring municipalities, such as the cities of Brecksville, Broadview Heights, and Seven Hills, for such commodities as road salt and the fuels used in the city's vehicles. By doing this, it allows us to purchase most of the city's capital equipment at the same discounted prices the state of Ohio pays. The best example I can offer is the city purchases an average of 5 new law enforcement vehicles each year so that we can spread out the cost of having them evenly and that we don't have to replace them all at the same time. Using the state's contract for law enforcement vehicles, instead of getting bids for 5 law enforcement vehicles, we get the same pricing as if we were buying 500 vehicles. If it was all about purchasing the cheapest goods as possible, our police vehicles would look like this instead of this. Simply put, participating in cooperative purchasing increases the city's buying power and saves the residents money. While we're committed to obtaining best value and best pricing, we do strive to include our local businesses in the city's supply chain. I want to assure you that wherever possible, we are always interested in local businesses capable of supplying the city's needs when they can be competitive. I want to assure you that our entire staff, all departments, are all on the same page when it comes to maximizing our resources and the delivery of services the residents of our city have come to expect. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jeremy Rowan, Economic Development Director. In the Economic Development Department, we primarily focus on 3 things: business retention and expansion, business attraction, and marketing. We also spend a great deal of time focusing on developing strategies to encourage future investment. Today, I will briefly highlight our efforts in these areas. Studies have found that between 70-85% of a city's job growth can be attributed to existing businesses. That is why business retention is so important. We have identified over 800 businesses operating in the city and interacted with almost every one over the last 18 months. During these meetings, we learn about and resolve many issues from our businesses. We have been working on traffic issues, resolving problems with utilities, coordinating with the post office to extend pickup times, searching for new office space, among many others. These can seem like small issues, but they are meaningful for our businesses and are important for business retention. Over the past year, we also have been working with a marketing firm to help us tell the independent story to a wider audience. Our efforts have resulted in the development of a new tagline for the city's economic development, Your Independence. We look forward to introducing the Northeast Ohio business community to the Your Independence brand. Along with telling the independent story to businesses, our department is working to plan for future economic growth. Last year, we completed a planning process that resulted in the adoption of an economic development strategic plan. The city's purchase of 33 acres in the northwest quadrant of Rockside Road, along with the recently launched planning process to develop area plans for our 5 commercial districts, were recommendations from the strategic plan and represent some of the first implementation steps from this initiative. The strategic plan identified the types of businesses that will find independence attractive due to our competitive advantages, while the area plans will provide recommendations to ensure our built environment evolves with the changing realities of today's business environment. Independence does not exist in a vacuum. We are part of the regional economy and must always strive to improve our regulatory environment, building stock, and sense of place to remain a viable business location. For these reasons and others, we are investing our time and resources in studies and planning, as well as making strategic investments in Rockside and downtown real estate. We are working hard to create vibrant mixed-use areas in both Rockside and downtown that will be attractive locations for our business and residential communities. This forward-thinking and investment is important, so Independence is positioned to identify, control, and develop its own vision for the future, and in so doing, maintain and improve the quality of life for the city's residents.
The city's finances are going swimmingly. Hi, my name is Vern Blaze, and I work in the mayor's office. Because just about every major decision made has some type of financial component or impact, that means that I get involved in quite a bit on Mayor Kurtz's behalf. The state auditor recently released the city's 2013 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, the CAFR. The CAFR details the city's financial position and condition, and I'd like to take just a few minutes to review some of those highlights now. But no discussion of the city's finances can begin before the multitude of people that are responsible for the city's strong financial position and excellent financial results are recognized and thanked. Those people are Mayor Kurtz, Finance Director Varis, Finance Committee Chairman Crooks, Finance Committee members Kapusta and Wisniewski, all of Council, the department directors, and their staff teams. So mine and Mayor Kurtz's thanks go out to everyone that is involved in preparing, analyzing, passing, and administering the annual appropriation ordinances. It is all of your dedicated time and attention that yields the excellent financial results and strong financial position that I will quickly review now. Everything starts with the top line number, or revenues. Without revenues, there is no money to pay expenses. The bottom line with revenue? General fund revenues increased by almost $2 million from 2012 to 2013. The city's expenses are paid out of that revenue. The bottom line with expenses? The city's general fund expenses increased slightly by $500,000 from 2012 to 2013. But notice that whereas general fund revenues went up almost $2 million, general fund expenditures only went up by $500,000. As long as revenues keep increasing faster than expenses, that is a positive trend. The unassigned general fund balance increased by $1.6 million from 2012 to 2013. That's a very healthy 23% increase. Another financial metric that we monitor closely is the city's cash balance. I'm sure many of you heard the saying, cash is king. And the stewards of your public tax dollars here in Independence certainly take that saying to heart. The bottom line with cash. The city essentially ended 2013 with $2 million more in cash than at the end of 2012, a healthy 10% increase. It's clear that since 2008, your city officials have been committing to reducing debt. Total debt reduction since its peak in the mid-2000s is approaching $13 million, with $1.2 million of that debt reduction occurring in 2013 alone. In the private sector, when you take the value of everything you own and subtract off what you owe, the difference is your equity. In the public sector, that difference is called your net position. So essentially, the city's net position is its equity. It is also one of the key financial performance metrics that financial analysts review when determining if a governmental entity's financial position has improved or deteriorated over a given time period. Going back 4 years, the city's net position has increased by $16.7 million since 2010. That 22% increase in the city's net position dating back that far speaks volumes about the success of your public officials in managing public tax dollars prudently and judiciously. So in summary, the city's financial position is strong, its financial results and performance is excellent, and the city's finances are going up.
One thing that I believe is really exciting to me is economic development. Economic development is crucial to solidifying a safe, stable, and strong financial future for the City of Independence. And we definitely have the team working hard on a daily basis to make sure we stay financially strong. As a matter of fact, I think each of you have a copy of this fact sheet at your table. Take it home, read it. Have any questions? Give me a call. Now, how many acres are still available in Independence for development, commercial development? How many acres? Okay, it's a clicker. While you're getting your clicker, I want to just acknowledge several people. I want to acknowledge Jim Gibbs and Kyle Collins. How about a round of applause for those two? Kathy Alexi and Dar Velada did a great job putting this all together. Okay, let's see the answer. 300 acres. And that is correct. So we have opportunity for expansion and growth. And that's exciting.
I just want to take a minute here and talk about the bicentennial and to let you know that it was almost 2 years ago when the mayor came to me and he approached me and he said, "Dar, we got to talk about this bicentennial because, you know, it's coming up in 2014 and you know that it doesn't come around all that often. So we need to make this a great year for our residents. This is our opportunity to do something, to create some good memories that they'll always remember." And what he wanted to do, he told me he wanted a year full of filled with fun activities and programs with centered around the bicentennial theme, and he wanted there to be something for everybody of all ages, and he also wanted it to be at little or no cost to the residents because he wanted you to be as involved as possible, wanted to get as many people to enjoy all the activities. So a little overwhelmed, I did what anybody in my position would do, and I went to my go-to people who you go to when you want to get something done. So I called upon Maggie Osisko and Marilyn Senek and Kathy Alexi, and we all put our heads together and we're trying to figure out how we were going to make all this happen. Well, we knew it was an overwhelming task and we couldn't do it alone, and that we were wanted to form a committee, and we wanted to get the residents involved because it's your bicentennial. So we wanted you to be involved as well. And we also knew that we needed to get somebody at the helm who could not only lead the charge, get us organized, but to get the people excited about the bicentennial and to get the ball rolling. And so we put our heads together and we all unanimously came up with one person's name. And that person is extremely talented and resourceful, energetic, positive, and organized. Best of all, this person loves this community so much. We were a little nervous about asking her to take this on because we know how busy she is, and we knew it was going to be an overwhelming, long task of her utilizing her energy and her resources. But we were very happy to say that, yes, she did say yes. And not only did she say yes, but she said it was an honor and a privilege to be to accept this position and do this for the community. So. We are very grateful for her dedication and her commitment to making this a wonderful year for all of us. I hope she knows that she has far surpassed our expectations and hopes for making this the spectacular year that the mayor really wanted.
To have you fooled, Dar. A little did I know when I was asked by Dar Vellat, I got the phone call. I was actually in Florida at the time when the idea of the bicentennial came up, and I said, sure, I'll help out wherever I can. And again, was given the honor of becoming chairperson, and I thank you, Dar, for that, and Kathy, and the support, Maggie. I mean, the list goes on, but as you all know, nothing great gets done without a lot of hard work and a lot of effort by a lot of passionate people, and we were lucky to have that here in Independence. So anyway, planning for the 200th birthday of Independence with the theme of proud past and bright future was about 19 months ago. Hard to believe. A lot of planning, hundreds and hundreds of hours of meetings, communication, connections, talking about what we wanted to do, what we wanted to execute, and we did a lot of it, that's for sure. We had the support of City Hall, the wonderful technical and service department, as you all saw, building and engineering departments, police and fire, and an amazing creative staff right here at the Civic Center. None of us could have done anything without every single one of these people, these support people that are, every single one, I can't even emphasize this enough, passionate about Independence, living here and making it great for you. And I'd like to sidestep my thought just for a moment as I was sitting here. We are so lucky to be here this morning to see about our city, really the roots of how things happen. Please go out and tell your family, tell your children, your grandchildren, your nieces and nephews that can't be here because they're working, they're at school, they're doing something else right now. I hope we can get this up on our website. Kyle's like, oh my God. But I hope we can pull this up to look at it again and again to remind ourselves of what we have. We are blessed as a community, and I can't say that enough. Do not take it for granted. We are so blessed, so be grateful every single day for everything that we have. Anyway, this past year for the bicentennial, we ate a lot. So we have our, really, we had the Taste of Independence, which was phenomenal. We had, it was a sellout, over 500 people, thanks to Lynn Kurtz and her staff. We had generations come together for an heirloom bridal show. We opened the doors to City Hall and the Fire Department for a City Hall open house. So you can see our beautiful facility and see how everything works and where the council meets and where a lot of decisions are made with the support of food from CBCC. So we had all of our students involved too all over the place. We enjoyed wine, beer, and cheese for the spirits of the bicentennial. We rode the Cuyahoga County Scenic Railroad to acknowledge our history with railroads in our community. And of course, enjoyed spectacular fireworks on the 4th of July this year, viewed historical vehicles while eating ice cream. We had a home days we'll never forget with torrential rains during the parade. But also, we have the opportunity to take our resident photo, which is available, and you have all the information in the Independence Post, which you probably all received this week. So this is all available for sale, and we still have our bicentennial logo painted in the street and the replica of the Independence welcome sign, thanks to our service and tech department. So, and it made Wes Scott very happy. Where's Wes? So we surprised him, yeah. So we couldn't do it without all of you guys. So we all played, we painted, we ate at the Clam Bake and Fall Fest this past week, and I thought at this particular time we would take a look back this past year, both old and new. So let's take a look and see our bicentennial year. Thank you.
So it's safe to say that it's a team effort in providing the quality of life that we've all become accustomed to. And the team members and every employee from the city works hard on your behalf on a daily basis. We have a bright future, full of opportunity, but it doesn't happen by accident. It takes vision, it takes foresight, it takes fortitude, and it takes teamwork. They equal stability and consistency. That stability and consistency equals the quality of life we're so blessed to have. But I'd be remiss before I finish if I didn't acknowledge that I look across the crowd and I see members of the greatest generation. Without you, without your commitment to come to Independence, to be part of the fabric of Independence, we would not be the community we are today. And I think the greatest generation needs a round of applause. Now, you've established this foundation, but if I look over on the far right, I'd like our high school students to please stand up. Come on, I know you're bashful. Now, the ladies there told me it was okay to dump the boys in the pool. But I assured them I'm not going to do that because we're all part of the same family. And talk about education, I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge and say one important ingredient to the success of this community is our school system. Let us not forget that when people come to pick Independence as their home, that's one of the barometers that they measure in terms of trying to determine where they want to locate. And so it's vitally important that we continue to support our schools with what funding they need and the support they need. We have a tremendous relationship with our school system. We work back and forth all the time. And I can honestly say that you are the beneficiaries of that. Now, I have to charge you with a little responsibility. Because as I used to tell my children every day when I dropped them off for school, make a difference in somebody's life today. I think it's important that you, at your stage in your life, you're here because you're the future of our community. And we expect you to go on to great things. But I also would encourage you to come back home. And come back home when you've gone out and continued your education and come back to make a difference in the life of future generations, because that's what's important and that's what's made the fabric of the city of Independence so critical to the future. The greatest generation created the foundation. You are the future. And so as I conclude, I just want to remember a saying that I used years ago when Augie Topolsky and Tom Walker helped craft the saying I still use today, leadership, a vision for the future with an appreciation of the past. To those of the greatest generation, I say thank you. To those students of the future, I say do the best you can and never quit. And to all of you that work for the City of Independence, that make this all possible, I want to say thank you.